Hey, what's up? Hello. Look where we are. A new location. A new day. To start off, I just want to say that I know that it's been a long time, and I want to thank everybody who, in the past on previous videos this year, has been able to comment and really encourage me to do well with my master's and take my time with that. It was really great to know that I had that support and that you all would not be upset that I took the time that I needed to do that. I just wanted to say that I am now done. I have finished my degree. My dissertation is being marked right now, and we shall see how that goes over. I should know by October. In the interim waiting period, I have moved and will be moving again soon, probably to somewhere else within the UK. Not entirely certain where right now, but I've also been working at a couple different jobs, and if you're familiar at all with the art scene in Edinburgh in August and really the entire summer, you'll know that busy is pretty much putting it lightly. But putting that aside, today I want to talk about Margaret Atwood, who has been one of my favorite authors for quite some time. We first read, myself and Rebecca, that is The Handmaid's Tale in 2009 when we were in high school, and it's been one of my favorites ever since. It was published in 86, originally 1986, and I think it really does remain one of the, if not the foremost, piece of dystopian literature out there. I'm sure somebody will have some argument with me that something else came first, but I think it was one of the books that sort of cemented the dystopian idea. But if you're not familiar with the story by now, this follows a young woman named Offred, and she is a handmaid in a dystopian society, and so this is a society in which the birth rate has declined, and so specific members of society who are women, who are still able to viably have children, are asked to attempt to do this constantly to sort of reproduce the society. I don't really want this to be sort of a series book comparison of that so much. There are a number of those floating around out there, and I've seen some really, really good ones. Katie at Chapter Stacks has some really nice thoughts about that. But I like this book, and it spoke to me considerably the first time I read it, and even more so the second time around. I wanted to read it ahead of the series coming out, so I started it in April and finished it in May, and in between I had watched the first three episodes of the series, and I have not actually seen the rest of them because I've been so busy, and also they're hard to stream here in this country. But Offred herself is an unreliable narrator in a way. She doesn't trust herself to tell the right side of the story, sort of that One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest idea of it's the truth even if it didn't happen. So you've got her side of the story that she's telling you, and then also the government who is telling her how things were and how things were not, and it's all perception and post-truth, if you will. That uncertainty is what this book hinges on. A lot of people have been saying that, you know, the series creates, there's the sun. The series creates this sort of fear and this anxiety, and it's gripping to watch what's happening because they've gone a little further than the book did and imagine different plot points which fit right in with the storyline. But I think the fact that Offred doesn't trust herself, and therefore you can't really trust her in her descriptions of anything that's happening, that uncertainty creates a sort of fear reading this, and these gaps that you have to fill in for yourself, or where you wonder what exactly is going on that she's unable to describe or hasn't described, or what happens between the chapters. The fact that Atwood lets you leave things to the imagination, and the ending of this novel ends the way that it does, makes it more compelling, I think, than something that has a definite ending. Because honestly, how do you end a dystopian story either in complete tragedy or complete utopia? There is no really good way to middle-ishly do that. That's a new word that I've just made up, middle-ishly. It's hard to find a really good way to split the difference between those ideas, and I think that she does it really well. I've given this book 5 out of 5 stars every time that I've read it. I highly recommend. It's just great prose, and if for some reason you have seen the series but not read the book, I highly recommend giving it a read and then maybe rewatching and see the interesting pieces. Also, if you've seen the series, you'll notice Margaret Atwood's cameo in the first episode, which I was so excited. I had no idea that it was coming, and then I saw her and I was like, oh, that's, there she is, that's her. The double feature part of this video comes from a book which I brought back home to the States with me in May and dropped off. So I went home in May to do my research and brought some of my belongings back there to just sort of lighten my luggage a little bit. And unfortunately, I brought this one back and don't have it with me to show you, but I will put a picture here so you can see what the cover looks like. It's called The Heart Goes Last by Margaret Atwood. And this was the second Margaret Atwood book that I have read. I have been really wanting to read the Oryx and Crake series that she's written, but I have not gotten around to it with all of my free time. Man, the sun is really out today. This is sort of a miracle. However, this is the first in what I think is the Positron series, and it is about, I believe, sort of America in a time where basically everything has been demolished and society doesn't really function as you would believe it would anymore. And so these two characters, they're a married couple, Charmaine and Stan, are living out of their car. They are incredibly poor. They both have very, very low-paying jobs, and they don't really have a lot of potential to move up because there is no society for them to move up in. So they hear about the Positron experiment, in which you sort of can go and sign up to live in this community, and it's a monthly thing, so for 1 month you live in a house, sort of, you know, with an everyday life, with a job, with a car, everything provided for you, money, food, all of that. You get a home or a flat, depending on the size of your family, and you live there for a month, and then the next month you're separated into men and women, and you go live and work in a prison. And sort of the concept is that, you know, the people in the prison make all of the things that are needed in life so that they can be given back to the society that everyone else is living in the other month. And so you share a house or a flat or whatever with another family. So for the month that you're living there, like in a normal type of life, it is yours, and then you clean everything so that it looks like you don't even live there. And then on swap day, you arrive at the prison and take up whatever your job is in the prison. For Charmaine, she's part of like a knitting circle, and they knit blue bears that are given to children in hospitals. And so that's sort of her role there. When she is sort of at home living a normal life, she works in the hospital. So the two of them are living there quite happily, of course, until something sort of starts to go a little bit awry. And this has to do with a tube of lipstick and a note that both Charmaine and Stan find sort of tucked in the refrigerator, presumably left there by the folks who are living there that they share the house with in the off month. And it becomes clear that they have a much larger role than just people that are living as part of this community. And I won't say any more because it really starts to get into the depths of the book and I don't want to spoil. So the chapters are all sectioned into parts, which are all quite cleverly titled to sort of lead you into the idea of what each part is going to be about. Charmaine was an extremely annoying and naive character, and I hated reading everything from her perspective because she just drove me absolutely nuts. I think that she really had a very narrow perspective on life. I think a lot of it was to do with her upbringing and the way that she viewed the world based on the way that she had been instructed by her grandmother, who plays a large role in influencing the way that she thinks. And she was the kind of character that you would expect something bad to happen to, and she does have strength, but it was clear that she was very, very easily manipulated. But she couldn't see that enough to not be manipulated, and I found her really, really frustrating. Stan felt annoying and boring and kind of like the perfect pawn, which I think is sort of what he was used for. He sort of was just blah and did what he was told. Like, he questioned things a little bit, but not to the point that I wanted him to. His relationship with his brother, who shows up in the story, the two of them are very different. They've led very, very different lives. That becomes really, really important, and I wanted to see sort of a little more of that, more of how that relationship came to be what it was, and then also a little bit of the afterword as well. The director of the community, his name is Ed, and he gets the role sort of as the dictator in the community, and I felt like he seemed like a bit of a generic dictator in a way. I didn't really know much about his motivations. I didn't know really where he wanted to go. He just seemed pretty run-of-the-mill, and like he wanted the money and the glory and the girl in the end. And it was just sort of bland in a way. I wanted to know more about what was driving him forward to take part in this project, and it's clear that at the age that he was not someone who had grown up in the society, and it was the only thing he knew. He would have had to come into it as an outsider, and I wanted to know more about what drove him, other than simple human nature, into this sort of way and life and capacity for being at the top and being in charge and wanting it all. And that really seems like enough right there. However, I felt like there could have been more motivators that we found out somehow, either through Charmaine or through another character named Jocelyn, who comes into the story about a third of the way through, and she was really my favorite. She was extremely power hungry. She was willing to do anything to get what she wanted, and you never really could tell whose side she was on, and I appreciated that about her, that she was so versatile and able to be that manipulator and be somebody who was also sympathetic to the rest of the characters, but you never quite knew about her, and all the way through to the very end, you don't know. And I think she was the strongest character and the one who was best written. She felt like she could have been the main character in the story instead of Charmaine or instead of Stan, but she wasn't presented that way, and I think that that was a smart choice, because if she had been presented that way, she would have gotten very tiring very quickly for the reader. That being said, she very much pushed the story along. Whenever she showed up in a piece of the narrative, you were wondering how she was gonna sort of manipulate Charmaine in a way, or how she was gonna manipulate Stan, or whether she was going to sit back and sort of make them feel like they were all playing for the same team, even when in some instances they weren't. I gave this book 4 out of 5 stars. I did have a number of challenges with the characters, but I think overall the idea was very, very sound. It's Margaret Atwood's writing, so it's obviously quite well written. This is not a book that I've heard a lot about, especially since her most recent one, The Hagseed, is more prominent and popular right now. But if you have read this, let me know down in the comments. I would love to chat more about it with you. I hope you all are having lovely weeks and lovely lives. Thanks so much for watching. All the information you could want is down below in the underbar, and we will see you very soon.